Good morning.
Good morning.
It's good to see y'all this morning. Let's go to the Lord in a word of prayer. Father, we are so thankful for the blessing of being in your house this morning. Thank you for watching over us all this week, being with us, giving us the strength that we've needed. Lord, we just pray as we've come this morning that you would be with those that aren't able to be here this morning. Lord, we know there are many that are sick and hurting this morning, Lord, just not able to come. May your hand be upon them, Lord. May they feel your presence. Lord, we pray that you would just have your will and your way in our service today. Be with our pastor. Lord, I pray your blessings upon him. Be with our choir and our musicians this morning, Lord, as we lift up our voices in song to you. And Lord, again, this morning we ask that if there's one here that doesn't know you as a Savior, that today would be their day of salvation. Lord, we love you. It's in Christ's name we do pray. Amen. Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Make you aware of just a few announcements before we go further in our services this morning. But tonight we will not be having services here at the church. We will be participating in the Association's Fall Singing. We will be down at Old Savannah Baptist Church tonight at 6 o'clock. Encourage you all to come out. It's going to be a great time. You know, these are not, and we'll get to Wednesday night in a minute, it's not just for the choir to show up at an associational singing or at Morning Star to go sing for them. We want the whole church to come. We want all of y'all to come and be a part of that. It's a great time to get together with her sister church, great time to get together with those folks down at Morning Star and just to worship together. So remind you of both of those. Tonight at 6 at Old Savannah, and then Wednesday night down at Morning Star. Tomorrow night, guys, we'll be out here again with our Bible study starting at 7 o'clock tomorrow night. I encourage you to come and be a part of that with us. And then next Sunday is a time that we all look forward to each year. We're going to be having our old-fashioned Sunday, so come on out and be with us. People may look a little different next week, but that's all right. We'll have a great time. And then after that, there's a reason. And the pastor mentioned it a while ago to Doyle, that you wear overalls on that day. We're going to Round Top after, and we're going to eat. You need that extra space. So wear your overalls next week so that you'll have extra space when we go up there. It's a great time. If you have a UTV, you can, or a four-wheeler and want to ride it up, bring it. They'll be riding up from here next Sunday on those, or if you don't, you can follow us around in the cars, and we'll go up there and have just a great time of being together up there and a great time of fellowship. excuse me. They are continuing to collect candy this month for the trunk or treat that'll be coming up at the end of the month. If you're able to bring some extra candy and drop it off, I know last year they were getting worried toward the end. We had such a great turnout that they were about out of candy. So encourage you to be a part of that. It is Socktober. If you see that for our Christmas child box, shoe boxes, we are encouraging you this month to buy an extra pair of socks or two as you are at the store this week. Bring it back next week, and we'll have that. Looking at it, we're almost, it's hard to believe how far along we are in this year and how far along we are in October. It's about time to pack those shoe boxes. We'll be doing that before very long as well. So I encourage you to do that. And if you've never been to a processing center and want to see how it works down there, we're going back down there. Kim has us a date that we're signed up to go to Atlanta and help out down there. So I encourage you to be a part of that. This is a great organization, great mission that they have. So you'll see all that there in the bulletin of things that are needed, so encourage you to participate in that. That being said, anybody else got anything this morning? Anybody? None of y'all got a thing to say?
I don't have
a thing to say. Oh, yeah, that's a shock. But
give me a few. I'm not.
Do what?
Give me a few.
I know you're still in recovery right now after last night. But, all right, we'll continue our services then.
We're going to start with page 141. We're going to sing The Old Rugged Cross, and it will be on the screen. Page 141, The Old Rugged Cross.
Mm-hmm.
one page to page 138. We're going to sing At Calvary. Page 138, At Calvary.
Oh, Rumble at our Choir, good job. Graciela, good job. Hey, church, good job. Hey, preacher, you better do a good job. Amen, that's what I'm talking about. That's what I'm talking about. You know, it's been a crazy couple days at the Gosnell House. We've had all kinds of things we've been doing. Trying to get things situated, you know, and taken care of, but that's for another note. If you have a copy of your Bible with you this morning, and I really hope you do, I encourage you to turn with me to the book of Galatians, the New Testament book of Galatians this morning. And we're going to be in chapter 3 as we've been working our way through the book of Galatians. You know, I keep going back to Paul is writing to the church at Galatia because he wants them to know of the goodness of God's grace, and it's by faith that we're saved through, or it's by grace we're saved through faith. And he says that in Ephesians and in the book of Galatians, he wants them to understand that it's all by the grace of God. It's by God's amazing grace that we're saved. It's by His sweet grace that we're saved. It's not by any works. It's not by any doing. It's not by any law or ritual. It's just the sweet grace of God. I thought I would have gotten a little amen. I know it's everybody's tired this morning. And how's everybody enjoying the weather? Everybody enjoying it? It's cooling off. The leaves are, well, they're about gone. But we got some leaf changing going on. Everybody ready for this week? If you don't know what's coming this week, just hold on, you'll find out. And if you are prone to getting cold, you're really going to find out. It's supposed to get down into the freezing below 30 two nights in a row. Amen. I know everybody's kind of, preacher, you're nuts. But it's okay. I know I've been claimed to be worse. But this morning, if you have your Bible open to Galatians chapter 3, we're going to begin in verse number 15. Galatians 3, beginning in verse number 15. The Bible tells us there, Paul speaking, he says, "Brethren, I speak in the manner of men, though it is only a man's covenant or promise, yet if it is confirmed, no one annuls or adds to it. Now to Abraham and his seed were the promises made. He does not say unto seeds as of many, but as of one, and to your seed, who is Christ. And this I say, that the law, which was 430 years later, cannot annul the covenant that was confirmed before by God in Christ, that it should make the promise of no effect." Verse 18, "For if the inheritance is of the law, it is no longer of promise. But God gave it to Abraham by promise. Would you join with me in a word of prayer? Father, thank you for your word. Lord, thank you for the promises that you have shared with us from your word and how we can rest in the promises of your word and we can stand on them and we can be assured of what you promised years ago, today, and that will always stand in effect. Lord, we love you so much and it's in Christ's perfect name. Amen. This morning, I want to preach on this subject, a promise is a promise. A promise is a promise. Now, I don't know about you, but promises are everywhere. I watch them, I read them, I hear about them. I'm an NC State football fan. For all of you who don't know, most of you do know now, and I'm promised a good season every year. Oh me, that's right. Me and Grant, Wolfpacker, well, we're dying, so it's okay. We're promised every year it's going to be a good one. Never really happens. I thought I was promised a good victory yesterday, but go Rocky Top. I had to swing there. I'm sorry. I love you, Leanne and Kenneth. Oh, I had to swing there. I had to. I couldn't resist. You know, when that happens, it's amazing. It is. When you watch that team play that team, it's always going to be just one of those games. And whoever wins, I know I'm going to get churched after this. It is. I know. Roll Tide. Roll Tide. Go Tide. But there's promises everywhere. You watch billboards, you'll see a promise. You watch the weather, they kind of halfway try to promise. You watch different ads, they promise this and promise that. Campaigns promise this and that. But the worst one have to be food on billboards. There's nothing worse than coming down 74 and seeing the Forger's Canteen Burger. And you say, my goodness, look at that. And then you get down there and you order it and they don't tell you that it's only this big around. And it's just the smallest little thing you've ever seen. But the worst promise I have to date when it comes to food, I bring up food because I know it relates, is Wendy's. They have a new phrase, a new guarantee. Fresh and crispy fries with every order. Excuse me. Hot and crispy fries with every order. Last time we went there, I had to choke down a packing peanut. It was one of the stalest French fries I've ever bit into in my life. And I first thought, somebody lied. Somebody lied. You see, a promise is a promise. And either someone is fulfilling the promise or they're going back on the promise. But a promise is a promise. And this morning, the Apostle Paul is sharing with the church of Galatia a faithful promise of God. He wants them to know. He says, let me tell you about the promise of old, a promise of God, something that God said way back when, a faithful promise that God has promised years ago, and yet it resonated with them, and it still resonates with us to this very day. A promise is a promise. So this morning, as we begin to look through God's Word here through verses 15 through 18, we're going to see how the Apostle Paul just shares with us and with the church there about the promise of God and how a promise is a promise. Look with me in verse number 15 in the beginning. He says, brethren, I speak in the manner of men. You see, the beginning of this is he wants to share with us, first of all, a reflection of the promise. It's a reflection. He says, this is in the manner of men. This isn't the same standard as God's promise, though it still works the same. You know, man is made in the image of God. We are image bearers of God. We're like the moon to the sun. We have no light of our own, but when the sun reflects its light off the moon, it then shines in the brightness. Man has no light in him, in ourselves, but we just reflect the light of God. You see, we reflect God in many things that we do. It is a manner of men. It is a reflection to how it really is. He is sharing with them a principle, not an absolute. He says, let me just teach you about the promise of God and how man's promise reflects it. And first of all, he begins in verse number 15. He says, though it is only a man's covenant, he has to make sure they understand this is limited. This is a limited understanding and a limited reflection because it's with man. You can't understand the full goodness of God's promises when you look at man. You have to look at His Word. You have to trust in His Word. And he says this is a man's covenant. It's similar to, but it's still limited very much because it's very fickle compared to God's promise. Because God is faithful and true. But he says there in verse number 15, yet if it is confirmed, if it is confirmed, and what he's talking about there is even though this is not a promise, a covenant on God's standards, it's still understandable because it is confirmed. It's as if whenever the seal has been made is what Paul is talking about. How many of you own a vehicle here? Not saying you're paying for it, but I mean you own that bad boy. What he's talking about confirmed is the same idea when the title comes in the mail. It's real. It's confirmed. It is paid. It is a confirmed promise. It is a guaranteed. Whenever you come through on your end, this is guaranteed to come through on the other, and the title comes in the mail for your vehicle, and you finally get that notarized piece of paper. It's confirmed is what he's talking about. Yet if it is confirmed, whenever you receive it, no one annuls or adds to it. It's absolute. Even though this is a man's promise, on man's standards, with man's terms, whenever it is confirmed and the title is in your name and you are the official owner, no one can annul or add to. That means whenever the debt's paid, guess what? There's not another dime you owe. That means it's yours. No one can annul it. No one can set it aside or add interest. The word annul literally means to say, you know, I know we made a promise, but I'm going to just set it aside because there's more that has to be done. No, 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 no. Whenever the title comes in the mail, guess what? They can't say nothing. The bank can't say, well, we need to go through this process. No, you do not. That is my vehicle. Well, it's notarized, but we need to go and we're going to set it aside because we have to go through another process. No, 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 no. No, we do not, because I've got the title. It's confirmed. You see, what Paul is talking about here is when he's saying, I speak in the manner of men, it is a simple reflection of the promise of God. It's a reflection. It's like an illustration. Some of the greatest teaching in my lifetime that I've ever been taught, and I guarantee in yours, was when someone used a good illustration. And what Paul was saying here is he said, let me just illustrate to you the promises of God. Let me illustrate to you how faithful God's promise is, how absolute it is. Even though I'm speaking in man's terms, when a promise is fulfilled, when a promise is confirmed, no one can ever change it. Now he gets to get into the good stuff. Is everybody ready for some good stuff? Good. I'm glad. I'm glad you're ready for some good stuff. So he tells us here, he just shares, first of all, a reflection to the promise in verse number 15. But now in verse number 16, he shares with us the recipient to the promise of God. The recipient to the promise of God, or excuse me, of the promise of God. It says in verse number 16, now to Abraham and his seed were the promises made. To Abraham and seed. It was the sole recipient of the promise of God. The only one, the sole recipient, the one who was on the other end, who was receiving the promise of God, was Abraham and his seed. They were the only ones who were receiving it. But notice, not only is it talking about the sole recipient, but the limited recipient. To Abraham and seed were the promises made. He doesn't say there was anyone else. He doesn't say that there was another character. He doesn't say that there was another individual. He doesn't say that there was another group, another class. He doesn't say that there was another tribe, another religion. There wasn't anything. It was only to Abraham and his seed. The recipient is the sole recipient of Abraham and his seed, and the limited recipient. No one else receives the promises of God other than Abraham and his seed. Do you want to know how you're blessed as a Christian today? It's through Abraham. They say, well, I thought it was through Christ. It is through Abraham. You got to follow the whole line in order to go all the way back, or you're going to miss. You see, it was the recipient. He blesses him. He sends the promise to Abraham, and his seed were the promises made. No one else. He is the only recipient, the only receiver of God's promises. It's to Abraham and his seed. But notice what he says here in verse number 16. He says, going forward, to Abraham and his seed were the promises made. Abraham was the receiver of a promise, the promises of God. Now, I always have to ask the question here. Whenever you see that, what is the promise of God? What is the promise of God? I don't know. There's too many answers. There's too many things. Too many promises. Heaven, glory, the eternal life, it's all there. It's the promise. And to Abraham and his seed were the promises made. He was the recipient of a promise. It was being poured out from heaven's throne where God promises. God is the one who promises this. Now it's important right here for us to understand something. Promise has two sides. Promise has two sides. The giver and the receiver. Promise has two sides to every promise. You cannot promise alone. You have to be promising someone. God cannot just say, I promise I'll never do it again. He has to promise to something. Man cannot just say, hey, I promise I'll never ever do that. Or I promise I will be there. I promise I will never say, roll tide again. Love you, Leanne. No, I want to see him win next year. I do. I actually kind of wanted to see him again because I've become a Saban fan. I like Nick Saban. He's cool. He's the man. After he chewed out his players, amen, that's what I'm talking about. For disrespect, atta boy. Sorry, that was a rabbit. I squirreled that. Every time you see a squirrel, sometimes you just got to chase it. I know, it happens. But every promise has two sides. Notice what he says there, as Abraham and his seed were the promises made. He was the receiver of a promise. God promised. God promised. Now, God is the one giving the promise, and Abraham and his seed are the one receiving the promise. A promise is as good as the giver. There is no better giver of a promise than God. He is faithful. He is truthful. He is always right and never wrong. God is faithful, and He is the best promise giver that there has ever been and will ever be. My mamaw always taught me a phrase. Now, I can't say the real thing. But she always told me, don't ever write a check that your hind end can't cash. Now, the word hind end, I'll let you fill in the blank there. But she done, don't ever write a check that you can't cash. Don't ever make a promise that you can't fulfill. Don't ever say that you'll do something if you're unable to do it and know you're not able to do it. Don't ever go forward and say that you can do it and never come through on your end. You see, God is one who made a promise because He is one who can come through. He made a promise to Abraham and his seed. He says, I promise to you, Abraham, the covenant that I made with you, of the land for your family, of the blessings of God to be poured out on all those in you. There is no better promise giver than God. He can never go back on His word. He can never go back on His word, ever. But notice also this, promises are as good as the giver, but promises are received by those who are the recipient. God promises Abraham and Christ, His seed, the blessings of God, the promises of God. You see, if someone promises to write you a check, you can try to go cash it, but it might bounce all the way to the bank. But you are the receiver. You see, someone can promise you the world, but at the other end of it, you have to receive the promise. You can't just say, oh no, they promised. You have to say, you know what? I accept your promise. I know too many people today and too many people in the world who have been promised something and they say, well, I know they promised it, but we'll see if they come through on it. Put your faith in them. Said, hey, they promised. And if they let me down, they let me down. But they promised. And I'm going to receive that promise. Amen. Anybody ever been hurt in here? Anybody ever had somebody do you wrong in here? And they say, I promise I'll never do it again. But in your mind, the whole time you're sitting there thinking, we'll see about that. How about instead you say, you know what? We will see about that. I trust you. And I'm going to receive that promise. And I'm going to be the one who takes it. And I'm going to take you up on your promise. You see, he was the recipient of promises. But notice as he says there, he does not say, and to seeds as of many, verse number 16, but as of one, and to your seed, who is Christ. The recipient is one who accepts the promises of God in Christ Jesus. He is the glue, the tie, the cement, the icing of it all. In Christ are the blessed promises of God. You can't get the blessings. You cannot get the blessings and promises of God apart from Jesus Christ. He is the only source of the blessing. He is the only sole recipient of the promises of God. He is the tie between promise giver and promise receiver. In Christ Jesus, you get the promises of God. Have any of you ever watched Storage Wars? Okay, I'm seeing some kind of yeses and some noes. What they do is they go to these storage units and they open it up and they said, well, we're going to auction it off and you can buy it or not. But in order to buy the good stuff inside, you have to take the whole thing. You don't get an option. You don't get to pick through the stuff in there. You don't get to say, well, I only want that box in the back. I don't want this stuff up here, and I don't want this stuff up here. In order to get what you want, you have to get all of it. If you want the blessings and promises of God, you got to get all of Christ. Someone says, well, I want the promises of God that's found in Christ, but, you know, I don't want that lordship stuff over here. I kind of want to live my life how I want to live it. Well, you know, I don't like the idea of repentance and of walking in faith. I just kind of just want to just live in the good stuff. You get all of it or you get none of it. Amen. Just making sure everybody's awake here. You get all of it or you get none of it. It's like Storage Wars. If you want to buy the goods, you want the idea of heaven, you got to have all of Christ. You don't get to pick and choose. You got to take the whole load in order to get what you are really after. You see, Paul shares with us the recipient of the promise. But in verse number 17, he wants to share with us some reassurance to the promise. He says, and this I say, first of all, it's his testimony. And this I say, it's the added testimony to the witness stand. Paul is sharing with them, hey, let me just add this for no extra charge. Let me just add this as well to make sure you understand, to really reassure you in what it is. And he tells them their testimony. But then he goes forward in verse number 17 and talks about time as well. He says, and I want to say that the law, which was 430 years later, cannot annul the covenant that was confirmed before by God in Christ. The law, which was 430 years later. The reassurance is time. When something happens later, it doesn't change what happened before. just because something different was there and something changed was there. It's a change in perspective. You have to take it in perspective. The law was not an addition to the promise. It was not an annulment of the promise. They were looking backwards for the truth. They were all standing there listening to the legalistic Pharisees and the Judaizers who were going back to the law and saying, hey, you know, as a Christian, you have to do this and you have to do that and you have to be circumcised and then you have to be baptized and then you have to take the Lord's Supper and then you have to do this and you have to do that because the law says... The law says you have to keep the Sabbath holy, so you got to start meeting on Saturdays. And the law talks about you can't eat pork, so you have to be careful. No more pork chops, Baptists, and no more bacon. And the law says you can't eat shrimp anymore. I've sinned terribly in that category. Oh, you can't do that. You can't do that. You can't do that because the law says. You see, they went back and tried to prove their point as looking back in history. But the problem is they didn't look back far enough. I have an in-law. I almost said outlaw, but I've got an in-law. One of her favorite phrases, well, Hunter, doesn't Jeremiah say follow the old path? Doesn't Jeremiah say follow the old path? We need to go back to the old paths. And she's trying to get back to about 1950. We need to go back to the old path. Back when it was wild, hot, and screaming, and yelling, and kicking, and snorting. We need to get to the old path. And I started to respond every time. I said, you're right, we do need to get back to the old path. Let's just all change our clothes, put on robes and turbans, and we're going to quit our jobs and start shepherding sheep, learn Greek and Hebrew, and we're going to follow the manuscripts of the New Testament in Greek because that was the true New Testament, which was inspired by the Holy Spirit. And instead of singing any hymn book, we're going to sing the Psalms only. If you want to go back, you might as well go back to the start. Follow the old path. Let's go all the way back then. You see, time is a very reassuring thing. They were trying to go back and prove their point. Well, doesn't the law say? Doesn't the law say? Doesn't the law say? And Paul said, you're looking back in the right direction. You just need to go a little bit farther. Go back 430 more years. Because time always reassures us accurately. Go back far enough to find the truth, not the preference. They were trying to prove their point rather than stand on the promise of God and His Word. Time is a reassuring thing. But notice what he says there in verse number 17. Even though the law was added 400 years and 30 years later, it cannot annul. It's the tenacity of it. I don't know about you, but sometimes in life, we just need to have a little bit of tenacity. Tenacious. You're saying, I'm a preacher, I don't even know what that means. I'll go ahead and explain to you. I'd love to because I've been in the dictionary all weekend. Planting your feet and saying, you're not going to move me. God's Word does not need to be defended. God's promises do not have to be proven true. They're already steadfast and sure. Someone says, well, I don't believe the whole Bible. Why not? I ain't got to prove it to them. They have to disprove it. Someone says, well, I don't agree with going back to the promises of God. Well, then disprove it. Tenacious. Steadfast and saying, I will not bend, I will not bow. The law of God may have came 430 years after, but it cannot annul the promises of God. Abraham and the promises that God made to him are tenacious. They are steadfast, a reassuring. God's promises cannot be moved aside. They cannot be set aside. What God promises is steadfast and true. And that's the assurance of it. It cannot be annulled. It cannot be set aside. It cannot be changed for the law. It is tenacious. It overrides. And he tells us there in verse number 17, not only is some reassurance his testimony and time and tenacity, but also truth. Because in verse 17 he says, and it cannot annul the covenant that was confirmed before by God in Christ. It was made absolute guarantee prior to the fact. It was the truth. It was affirmed in Christ Jesus. Someone asked me, they said, when did Jesus die? I said, in the mind of God, eternity past. You see, in a chess game, a master chess player guarantees their victory before the game even starts because they know every possible move. They know if their opponent moves this pawn or this rook or this bishop or the king or the queen in any direction, they already have it planned out. If they make the move, they know how to beat them. In Christ Jesus, God said checkmate before time even began. He said the victory is already won in Christ. The promises are already setting in the lap of Jesus Christ alone. The law couldn't change it. Death couldn't change it. Sin couldn't change it. I couldn't change it, and you couldn't change it. Jesus Christ wins the game. And in Him are the promises of God. God knew beforehand, in Christ, before the law, before the promises, before the foundations of foundations. He knew the plan. He knew the motion. And the moment it started, He said, checkmate, Jesus wins. He said, checkmate, Jesus wins. Now, if you don't play chess, I'm sorry that that just kind of didn't set with you. I like playing chess a little bit every now and then, but I'm more of a checkers man because it's easier. But I've always been fascinated by the fact that God knew every move. And before time began, He said, Jesus wins. It's the truth. He said, Jesus wins. He shares with them some reassurance in verse number 17. And that it made, and that before, or that was confirmed before by God in Christ, that it should make the promise of no effect. The law changed nothing. Now verse number 18. I'll get ready to wrap it up here. It begins, He shares with us a reflection to the promise of God, a reflection, and then He shares the recipients of the promise of God, of Abraham and his seed, who is Christ. And then He also shares some reassurance with us in verse number 17 about the truth and the tenacity of God's promise. But now He wants to share with us our reality, the reality that we live in. Verse number 18. For if the inheritance is of the law. Our reality is this. God's family has an inheritance. God's family has an inheritance. Aren't you glad to know that you have a daddy with a bank account who ain't got no limits? Amen. Only thing I got from my family is I know how to open a beer bottle with my teeth. You think I'm joking? That's the only thing I've ever learned. From one side, I know how to open it up. But we have a Father who gives us an inheritance with no limit. For the inheritance of God. Now, what is the inheritance really and truly? Is it heaven? Is it forgiveness of sins? Is it the grace of God? Is it the eternal life we're promised after? Is it the abundant life we now have in Christ? The answer is yes, 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 and yes. We get it all. It's a package deal. There's a parable in the New Testament of the prodigal son, but it's really about the faithful father. And you see the prodigal son says, I want my inheritance, as he takes it and runs away. And he goes and splurges it and spends it all and goes on a spending spree and spends it on everything under the sun. But his spiteful brother is at home. Whenever he shows back up and says, Father, I have messed up. And the father puts a ring on his finger and kills the fatted calf in order to celebrate. The son, the spiteful one, says, well, that's not fair. Why is he getting all the good stuff? Because he come back. And the Father shares with them something we need to learn as Christians. You've had access to it the whole time. Whenever you see that young Christian who seems as if they're just fired up like they couldn't ever imagine and the hand of God's all over them, you have access to the same thing. It's the same access. It's the same promise. It's the same inheritance. God's family has an inheritance. He is giving us His inheritance of life, of freedom from sin, of eternal life, of an abundant life now. We get it all. And we've had access to it the whole time. It's not when we get to heaven that we get it all. It's right now. We have it all in Christ Jesus. I have eternal life. I have abundant life. I have the victory in Jesus. I have heaven. I have God's Holy Spirit inside of me. I have everything that God promised right now, and so do you. We have full access to it all. Our reality is this, is that if you're in the family of God, you have an inheritance that you've already got. And you don't have to wait for your family to die. But notice as he says in verse number 18, "For if the inheritance is of the law, it is no longer of promise." He shares with us two very important things of the reality. If by law, it's not guaranteed. If by law, it is not guaranteed. If it's of the law, it is no longer of promise. What does that mean? It's no longer God's promise to give, but our ability to do. If your Christian faith is your ability to do, if your Christian salvation is about what you have done, it's more about you clinging to Him rather than Him saving you. It's either by promise or by law. You see what Paul says there is if it is by law, if it's by law, then it's no longer a promise. It's no longer up to the one who made the promise to give. It's by you to get it. Making sense? Someone says, "Well, I don't get it, preacher." Because I'm seeing some looks here. I can't tell if you're getting it all. Are you clinging to God or is He clinging to you? Because if it's you clinging to Him, it's all by work. It's all by law. And it's no longer a promise. I'm standing on the promises of Christ my King through eternal ages. Let the ages ring. I'm standing on them. I don't have to cling to Him. Because He's got me. I just get to rejoice in what He's given me in the inheritance. If it's of the law, if your faith is by the law, if your faith is how tightly you can cling to Him, you are not receiving the promise. But notice what he says there in verse number 18. "For if the inheritance of the law, it is no longer of promise. But God gave it to Abraham by promise." Paul shares with us, as he shared with them, it is by the promise of God that He gave it. It's by His word. It makes it guarantee according to the giver, not the receiver. God's salvation, God's promises, God's inheritance is not hindered if you accept it or not. It doesn't change it. It doesn't afflict it. It doesn't bother it. It doesn't hurt it. Rather, what it is, it's just His blessed promise that is given. And if you accept it and you take it by promise, amen. And if you don't, it just goes to show how dumb and depraved we are. You see, it is by promise that God gave it. It is by the promise of His Word. God gives His inheritance according to His promise, not our work. We don't have to work. All we have to do is rest in the promise of God. We have to rest in the assurance of it. That's the reality of it. We have too many people trying to do and be better. And work our way up and say, "Oh, I'm going to just be better today. I'm going to rest in it today. I'm going to do more today. I'm going to be a better Christian today than I was yesterday." But in the reality of it is, you can't. You simply stop and say, "I'm tired of working the law. And I'm going to accept your promise of your inheritance. And rejoice in it. And reside in it." Paul says, "I've been crucified with Christ. I've been freed from the law because I died with Christ. I'm receiving the promises of God in Abraham because I'm no longer trying to look at the law, but I'm looking to God's promise. I'm not trying anymore. I'm done trying, but I'm going to live. I'm going to live rather than try." Trying is dead. And lead you to death and failure. But just stopping and saying, "I'm going to live in the overflow of God's promise. So in closing, we can see how good God's promise is. God is the God of His Word, and He never crosses His Word. If God made a promise, He will fulfill it. God promised to bless Abraham. He promised the seed who is Christ Jesus. He promised to come again. So guess what? He's coming again. In Christ are the promises, and to Abraham was the promises made, because God's a God of His Word. God is a God of His Word. A promise is a promise, and God is faithful to His promise. So there are only two questions as we close today. Only two. Only two. Number one, have you trusted in the promise of God? That's it. Have you said, God, I'm going to accept Your promise rather than me try to work my way to You? You have to ask yourself that question. Have I accepted the promise of God? Question number two. Am I trying to work my way to it? If you are, you need to quit. Just stop. Repent where you're at and say, Lord, I'm done trying to be what I can't be, because I'm going to need You to make me what You want me to be. Jerry Chaddick preached a sermon this past Wednesday night. Great message. And he said, you know what? Too many people are upset because they're big toes and they want to be eyes. Says the body of Christ, we're the body. He's the head and we're the body. Too many people are big toes and they want to be something different. I don't want to be that. I don't want to do this. I don't want to do that. I want to be something different. I don't want to be a big toe. I don't want to be a pinky toe that always gets stubbed up on the edge of the bed. I want to be an elbow. Stop trying to be what God has not made you to be. And stop trying. And say, Lord, I stop. And I'm going to rest in Your promise of whatever You have called me to be, whatever You want me to be, whoever You want me to be, wherever You want me to be, because it's all about You, not me. Have you accepted the promise? And are you trying to work to get there? Ask yourself that question. Ask yourself those questions. Is your faith more about your working ability than God's promise? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we love You so much, and we thank You for Your promise. The promise of an inheritance, the promise of the abundant life, the promise of victory in Jesus, the promise of eternity, the promise of heaven, the promise of Your Spirit. Lord, we thank You so much for fulfilling Your promise. And Lord, now and here today, if there be someone who is still trying to do, let them stop and realize that it's done in You. Let them realize and understand that the promise was made on Your Word, not on our ability. And that all we have to do is accept Your promise. And Lord, we love You and we thank You for all You do. And it's in Christ's perfect name. Amen.